coming Thursday's ITV's top-rated discussion show, The Time, The Place, will be broadcast live from Norwich. If you'd like to join our studio debates, call now on 0891 111126. That's 0891 111126. Now on Anglia, the news at 10 from ITN.
Quarters of ITN, News at 10, with Trevor Mcdonald.
Liverpool buries the child whose death touched the world. Police at bay as the Texas cult siege continues. The Bosnian food drop, but is it in the right hands? And Exit the Princess as a new controversy surfaces. Good evening. Kirby, near Liverpool, said goodbye today to James Bulger, the two-year-old who was abducted and murdered. Many who attended the Requiem Mass at the Sacred Heart Church or who listened outside wept openly. The parish priest said something in James had touched the whole world, and he said, "The death of an innocent little child compelled us all to do something to make life better." The Michael Jackson music James used to love to dance to was played. So was Eric Clapton's Tears in Heaven. Our North of England correspondent Jonathan Munro has this report.
The flowers spelled his name, a name now synonymous with the collective grief of Merseyside. Hundreds of locals watched, many in tears, as the infant coffin of James Bulger was lifted by his father and uncles into their local church. His life, they were told, was not lost in vain, because other children are now benefiting from the generosity of the public in the wake of his death. Every detail of the funeral mass had been planned by his parents, the cameras allowed in with their permission.
His death was not in vain. Something in James Patrick has touched the whole world, and we wish that we could turn the clock back 2.5 weeks. We wish we could make things better. We wish so much that we could bring James back.
The service was led by both Catholic and Anglican clergy, a symbol of the universal mourning. The detective leading the police investigation spoke of the death of young children.
Let the children come to me. Do not keep them from me. The kingdom of God belongs to such as these.
For James's family, especially his parents, Denise and Ralph, that they may feel the healing power of Christ in the midst of their pain and grief.
Make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race.
His parents listened to James's favourite Michael Jackson record. His teddies, a reminder of such a young life lost, perched on a chair made for him by his father. Music too from Eric Clapton. Tears in Heaven, written after the death of his own son. Liverpool has been deeply scarred by this murder. At the scene of James's disappearance, shoppers stopped to watch television coverage of the funeral. A firm grip was kept on toddlers. James's burial was private. Among the flowers at his grave, a poem from his parents. You brought so much love in our lives that love for you will never die. In our hearts, you'll still be here, locked inside our loving care. They were told during the service to grieve fully and cry openly. Much of Merseyside has done just that. Jonathan Munro, News at 10, Liverpool.
Westminster Cathedral, Westminster Abbey and other churches up and down the country also marked James Bulger's death with special services. His murder shocked people and pricked consciences, and it ensured that crime, especially juvenile crime, went to the very top of the government's agenda. The government will soon announce plans to lock up persistent young offenders. Tonight, Cardinal Basil Hume has suggested a royal commission into the way society is going. Our political editor Michael Brunson reports.
It took, said a Tory minister in a weekend speech, the death of a child on Merseyside to make the nation angry about violence and disorder. And the wider question is, yes, but what difference will it make?
A question which touches Jeffrey and Aura Joseph in the most direct way possible. Their daughter Sharona, 2 years old, like Jamie Bulger, was murdered exactly 5 years ago. Now their case is news again, but there was no public outcry then. Jeffrey Joseph wonders what will follow the concern now.
I don't believe that politicians will make any difference. The difference between James today and Sharona 5 years ago, only for simple reason that it's politically expedient. Somebody's making a noise in Parliament. I think that's the only reason. But nobody worried about a little girl of two.
I therefore believe that I was appointed...
Ministers, though, say juvenile crime has long been on their minds. Remember, they tell you that the idea of locking up persistent young offenders, which the Home Secretary will formally announce later this week, was in his conference speech last October. And Mr. Clark's predecessor, supporting his plans, rejects the idea that juvenile crime is the Tories' fault.
I think that a lot of the problems that we have in our society today weren't created when Mrs. Thatcher became Prime Minister. Greed and envy and anger have been with us since the Garden of Eden.
Labour, though, worries that the government's plans now are too narrow, too short-term.
I think it's desperately important that the government take proper measures to protect people in their communities and to bear down on rising crime. But as well as the short term, the government's also got to address the long term underlying problems of poor education, poor employment and training opportunities, and give our kids a stake in society so that there's then a better chance of them behaving responsibly.
Nonetheless, James Bulger's death has had the effect of making ministers, all of them, review their plans, not just on juvenile crime, but on things like truancy in schools and the need for teachers and social workers to teach children the distinction between right and wrong. But as James's parents grieve today, the minds of many politicians here have turned to those other parents whose firmer hand may perhaps in the past have prevented, or will in future help to prevent, such horrible things occurring. Michael Brunson, News at 10, Westminster.
More than 200 heavily armed American police are tonight still being held at bay by members of a religious cult holed up in their Texas headquarters. Six people have already died in one gun battle, and the leader of the cult, David Koresh, is said to be seriously wounded. He believes he's Jesus Christ. Others say he's a child molester. His family tonight pleaded with him to surrender. Our correspondent Bill Neely reports from Texas.
An uneasy truce at the fortified compound today, in stark contrast to the bloodshed before.
Federal agents.
Dozens of federal agents and sharpshooters were met with a barrage of gunfire from the heavy weapons they'd come to take from the cult. An assault from the roof, ending in death. One agent injured as bullets fired from inside pierce a wall. His colleague lay dead beside him. Another wounded agent pulled away to safety. They had trained for this attack for weeks, but never expected this. The call for a ceasefire allowed the four dead and 18 injured to be brought out. A two-year-old child inside the compound was killed. 8 hours later, a second battle. One cult member killed and one injured, trying to shoot their way out.
The main problem we had, I don't believe, is that we were outmaneuvered or outplanned. The problem we had is that we were outgunned.
The cult leader, David Koresh, who was wounded, heads 70 followers who believe he is the Messiah and that the end of the world is near.
So how's God going to talk to me in the latter days? And who's going to bring that book? So there'll be no excuses.
In a recent interview, he said threats from non-believers justified having so many weapons.
They come in here with a gun and they start shooting at us. What would you do?
One man who left the group says Parrish is deadly.
They will defend him with their lives. That's what they'll do.
Innocents have suffered too, though Parrish has begun to let children from the compound go. After a humiliating retreat, federal agents have brought in armored personnel carriers and reinforcements. They will need them. A cult that believes in Armageddon is behaving as if it is at hand. The lines are being drawn for another battle. Bill Neely, News at 10, Waco, Texas.
And our correspondent Bill Neely joins us now from the scene of the siege in Texas. Bill, any late news you can give us?